Spirit overshadow him, so that we don't look at a man, but we hear what God has in store for us. Amen. God bless you, man of God. We appreciate you.
Hallelujah. Let's pray in Jesus' name.
You are life.
I am life. Can I use my pulpit?
Yes, please.
Shall we pray? Father, in Jesus' name, we give you the praise, we give you the glory, we give you the adoration. There is no God like you, Jehovah. You are higher than a lifter up. You are God who's unique in your class. You are God self-existing. You are God self-sufficient. You are God all-knowing. You are God all-powerful. There is no one who can compare to you, Jehovah. You are God unique in your class, Lord. You have no rival. You have no competition. You have no equal. You have no challenger. No one can overthrow you, O God. For you are King eternal. To you be the praise. To you be the worship. To you be the adoration. We worship you, Lord. We give you the praise. We give you the glory. We acknowledge you in this place. For you are God omnipresent. You are present everywhere at all time and in your fullness. Lord, whether you acknowledge or not, you are there. So we choose this hour to acknowledge you. The glory of Israel. Jesus, we worship. The only begotten of the Father. Full of grace. Full of truth. The one who was and is to come. The one that the entire heaven is a worship. To you be the praise. To you be the worship. Spirit of Jesus, we acknowledge you. The Spirit of the Lord. The Spirit of wisdom. The Spirit of understanding. The Spirit of counsel. The Spirit of might. The Spirit of knowledge. The Spirit of the fear of the Lord. The Holy Ghost of the living God. You are all we acknowledge. Have your way. Have your way. The Spirit of glory. Oh, Job called you the breath of the Almighty. Breathe in us once again. Breathe in our spirit. Breathe in our soul. Breathe in our body. Awaken the deposit within us, Lord, that we may glorify you. We give you the praise. We give you the glory. We thank you, Lord, for this gathering. Into your name, receive the worship, receive the adoration. God of Abraham, God of Isaac, God of Jacob, the God who keeps covenant, the God who in the beginning, before any beginning began, the God who is eternal. Ah, you are in the beginning before any beginning began, yet you are no beginning, no ending. You are God eternal. There is no one like you. Receive our worship. Receive our adoration. Receive our thanksgiving. Let your name be glorified, even through your words. Let Jesus be lifted on higher. Let all the praise, all the glory back to you. For you are not a man. To you be the worship. To you be the adoration. Have your way upon this congregation. We pray for every life here today. Let there be an awakening in the name of Jesus. Father, we pray against any work of darkness against this work. In the name of Jesus, by divine authority, we declare any agenda of the enemies here now aborted in the name of Jesus, Son of the living God. We declare this is a holy ground, a place of an encounter with you in the name of Jesus. Let the heavens open over us. May you receive our worship. May you receive our praise. We receive our prayer as incense before you. Let us see answers, O God, to the cry of our heart in the name of Jesus. Let our generation, Lord, experience an awakening. Let us see revival. Let it be reformation. Let it be the genuine in the name of Jesus, Son of the living God. In the city, in the nation, Lord, that we experience an awakening. Let there be revival in our time, in our city, in our generation. That the name of Jehovah may be glorified. You alone we love for. We worship you, Lord. We give you the praise. We give you the glory. The God who is absolutely distinct from all creatures. You alone deserve the worship. You alone deserve the worship. You alone deserve the worship. Glory, glory, glory in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Please, you can have your seat in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen.
Thank you, saints of God, for the opportunity again to stand before you. We don't take these things for granted. Amen. It's not a hobby, it's not a profession. So it's a sacred thing. So we don't take it lightly, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Today I brought my wife. My wife, please, if you can wave to the people of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. That's my wife. Revelation chapter 4. Amen. Let's read Revelation chapter 4. I'm just going to read from verse 8. Revelation chapter 4. As you know, when you get to Revelation chapter 4, please shout amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Then verse 4 says, the four living creatures, each having six wings, were full of eyes around and within. And they do not rest day or night, say, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.
Amen.
Verse 9, and wherever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne, who lives forever and ever. Verse 10, and the 24 elders fall down before him who sit on the throne and worship him, who lives forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne. Because you can't worship God when your crowns are still on. The crowns have to be cast down before God. For the worship, it needs to be true worship. You can't have your crown on and God's crown is on at the same time. When it's come to worship, the crowns has to be cast down. Because there is not worship until the crown has to be cast down. So they cast down their crowns before the throne. Say, verse 11, you are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor. And now they are giving the reason of the worship. For you created all things. And by your will, they exist and were created.
Amen.
Now John, after writing chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, he hears the voice and say, come up. The heavens open. When the heavens open, it sees an amazing scene of the throne room of God. The throne established. They around the throne, there are four living creatures. Around the throne, there are 24 seats. And upon those 24 thrones, sit 24 elders with their crown of gold upon them. And the entire scene of heaven is focusing upon the one who's sitting on the throne of glory. No one is wondering about the thunder that is there. No one is wondering about the sea of glass that is there. No one is wondering about the things around. All the entire heavenly focus is upon the one sitting on the throne of glory. I am here today to talk about the worship of God. That one of the sacrifices from your altar is called worship. And worship touches the heart of God. And God does not want to be shared. He said, I am a jealous God. Why? Because he doesn't want anybody else to touch worship. Worship exclusively belongs to God.
Amen.
That way the entire heaven are worshiping God alone. Now quickly, the reason I read in the book of Revelation, because it's presenting us with the highest form of worship that can be found in anywhere part of the Bible. Heaven presents us with that highest form of worship. Now in the book of Revelation, when sometimes people don't read Revelation and they leave it to the future, but in the book of Revelation, there are things that you will find there that are already past, but they are in the Revelation.
Amen.
The are told in the revelation, you discover revelation 12, that the war broke out in heaven, and Lucifer and his angel, they are fighting, but they could not prevail. They were kicked out. But you discover that in Revelation, the devil is not in the abode of God. The devil is out, and God did not even come out of his seat to fight. Archangel Michael has to deal with it, because he's the minister of defense when it's come to heavenly affairs. So he dealt with the enemy until he was kicked out of heaven. That you find in the book of Revelation. In Revelation as well, you find things that are about the present. Last week we dealt with you and I being priest in the New Testament. And when you are a priest, Revelation says he has washed us from our sins in his own blood, and he has made us kings and priests unto God. You are not going to be priests. You are already priests. You find it in Revelation. So there are things in there that are in the present. Amen. And as well, we find things that are deal about the future, the end time. The second coming of Christ is in the future, hence he has not returned yet. Amen. The new Jerusalem is in the future, hence it has not happened yet. Those things you find in the book of Revelation. Now, the reason now I am reading this, one of the things that you discover in Revelation, as a student of the Bible, you need to know, when I'm reading the book of Revelation, am I reading about the past, or am I reading about the present, or am I reading about the future? That's why even Jesus Christ in Revelation chapter 1 verse 8, when he introduced himself to John, he says, if you can put it on the screen, 1 verse 8. Revelation chapter 1 verse 8. So when he introduced himself, he says, I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord, Amen. Which is present, which was past, which is to come future. I mean, God occupied the entire time. There is no time he ceases to be called. So when we read about that as a student of the Bible, you need to understand, am I reading about is, or am I reading about was, or am I reading about is to come?
Amen.
And one of the things that you discover that is presently happening is called worship. Now, when it's come to the worship of God, almost the same scenario Isaiah many years before this encounter of John saw, almost the same thing. Isaiah chapter 6, let's read. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1, 2, and 3 says, if it was on the screen, Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. Isaiah now is encountering. I saw Adonai sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Verse 2, above it stood the seraphims, each one having two wings, six wings rather. With two he covered his face, with two he covered his feet, and with two he did fly. Is describing the seraphim. And then he said, and then verse 3, now where I was interested, and one cried unto another, holy, 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 the Lord of hosts and the whole earth is full of his glory. Amen. So the worship, this encounter of Isaiah, and many years later, John the Revelator at the island of Patmos, he have this encounter, and when he's called up to come to heaven and see the heavens open, he's having almost the same scene, experiencing the worship of God. So worship, one of the things you need to know about worship, it is continuously happening. There is no time where worship ceases. Though here on earth you can say, let us express our worship, and we stop. When we stop, it does not mean worship has stopped. It is a continuous thing that is happening before the throne of grace. That way is, for example, when you tune into the radio now, you will find there is a debate in the radio, but the debate did not start because you tune into the radio. You found the debate there already being discussed. Now when you come out of the radio, the debate continues. Amen. you, you have switched off, but there's those debate continues. So you can speak to that as a worship. When we come to worship, it's a continuous thing. Worship is continuously happening. And the worship that God is continuously receiving is the highest form of worship. That's why as a believer now, when it's come to worship, you cannot give God any lesser type of worship. You can't give your change. You can't give what you don't need in worship to God. Because at all time, is continuously receiving the highest form of worship. So the worship of God is continuously happening there. Now, when we go back to the scripture we read, Revelation 4, verse 8, it says, the four living creatures, each having six wings, almost what Isaiah saw in Isaiah 6, were full of eyes around and within, and they do not rest day or night, meaning it's a continuous thing. And what are they doing? They are saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. And whenever the living creatures, verse 9, give glory and honor and thanks to him. As you can see, the entire setup, they are all focusing upon the one who is sitting on the throne, who lives forever and ever. One of the descriptions about the one who's sitting on the throne, it means he does not die. He is continuously sitting on the throne. And Paul says he is a king eternal, meaning there is no time he ceases to exist. The one who lives forever and ever. And the 24 elders fall down again, what? Before him. So there is a focus about the him there. So one of the things, few points I want us to deal with in this scripture is that when it's come to the worship of God, number one, there must be an object of worship. What are you worshiping? Or who are you worshiping? That is the question. Because when it's come to worship, there must be the one to whom the worship is rendered to. That's what I'm calling to as the object of worship. And in here in heaven, in that amazing scene that Isaiah saw, that John saw, the entire heavenly being focus is upon the one who's sitting on the throne of glory. So there is no any misinterpretation. There is nothing, there is no gray area. They know the one who's sitting on the throne of glory is their object of worship, is their center of admiration, is their center of attention. All the entire heaven is focusing on the one. Now the one who's sitting on the throne is God, is the Lord of heaven and earth. So the church of Christ here on earth, we do have the same and only object of worship, the one sitting on the throne of glory. So when you are worshiping, who are you worshiping? Who is at the center of your heart? Who is the object of your admiration? Who is the object of all the attention that you are giving in worship, in reverence, in paying homage, in adoration? There must be an object of worship. Amen. When it's come to worship. So therefore, for you and I, and children of God in the land of South Africa, our object of worship, number one, is not a building. We do not worship buildings. I know they are Christians. They decide which church to go based on the beauty of the building. But they are missing out on the main point that our focus is the one sitting on the throne of glory. Is to have a nice building a good thing? Yes, it is a good thing. Reflecting the worth that we have toward God. But the building is not God. The building is not our object of worship. When it's come to worship, it's God alone. Amen. Who deserves the worship. And when you read, if you can read, Acts chapter 17, verse 22, talking about the object of worship. Amen. It is not a building. We do not worship buildings. People of God, we do not worship buildings. Amen. A building is a place of worship. us to be nice to reflect how we are worth, how the worth we have toward God. Amen. But we should not be lost in the beauty of the burning and miss out on our Creator. The object of worship is key. So it is not a burning. Paul says in Acts chapter 17 verse 22. Then Paul stood in the midst of the Areopagus and said, Men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are very religious. You are superstitious. It means you are people. You know how the things about religion, about worship. You are very religious men of Athens. Verse 23. The reason I'm saying that is because, for as I was passing through and considering the objects, plural, of your worship, I even found an altar with this inscription to the unknown God. Let us explain quickly. Now, the people in Athens in those days, they were idol worshippers. They had multiple gods that they worshipped. So that when Paul is saying, when I was going through, I find altars, many altars. This altar you have raised to that God with an inscription. This altar you have raised to the other God with an inscription. This other altar you have raised to other God. Then you have many altars for many gods because you are no longer allowed to bring any new God. So in case there are many and you have missed out on one, this altar is to that God. That's the man of Ethan. Now, because now Paul is using what they say, this is unknown to another. If in case there is another God, this is altar is to that God which we do not know, and instead put the inscription to the unknown God. Are you understanding? Now he's using that to introduce to them Jehovah God. So he says now to the unknown God, therefore, the one whom you worship without knowing, I am proclaiming to you. Verse 24. God who made the world and everything in it, since he is the Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with man hands. God does not sit in temples that men have constructed for him. When God manifests, it's not because the temple is look nice. The carpet is nice. The chair look nice. The ushers are all in uniform, white, clean. Everything is clean. Then God manifests. No, he does not dwell in temples made with hand. Verse 25. No, he is worshipped with men's hand as though he needed anything. It's as if you are giving God a favor. No, since it is he who God gives to all life and breath and all things. When we gather here, it's for God. Amen. When there is the manifestation of God's presence, it's not because the place is nice. It's because there are people in that gathering, they are yearning for God. They are in love of one another. There is unison. There is purity. Then God manifests.
Amen.
God is omnipresent. But God, when there is a, when you experience the presence of God, that one now is called the manifest presence. Amen. Because God is omnipresent, meaning God is present everywhere at all time in his fullness. That dimension, number one, you need to understand. And number two is that he indwells us. There is the indwelling presence of God. Because when one is born again, God come and take residence in them. As the Bible says, you are the temple of God, the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. That's the indwelling presence. But there is the third dimension, which we always yearn and cry for. It is the manifest presence. So he says, God does not dwell in temple made with man's hand. No, his worship with man's hand as though he needed anything. Because it is he who gives to all life and breath and all things. Are we together? So us as the children of God, when we are worshiping, we are not worshiping a building. A nice building, is it good? Yes, it is. It reflects, wow, this is how much our heart is valuing God. But the building itself is not what we are worshiping. Are we together?
Amen.
Number two, when it's come to the worship of God, we do not worship as Christian, we do not worship a man. We We don't worship human beings, whether they are dead or they are alive. They do not receive our worship. When they are alive, and especially when you are in a place where miracles are happening, whether they are true or not true, but the miracles are happening. When you are in a place where prophecy are there at all times, the tendency of the human being is that the reverence that is due to God now shifts from God to the man of God. Worship belongs to God. No man is worthy of worship. No leader is worthy of worship. No bishop is worthy of worship. No pastor is worthy of worship. No apostle is worthy of worship. No, either the Pope is not worthy of worship. Worship only belongs to God. So glory say, that's why it says, my glory I will give to honor and no other. You shall have no other God. No, my glory I will share with no other. The reason is called a jealous God is not jealousy from the human perspective, but it's jealousy that the worship that he deserves cannot go to any other. Amen. Worship only belongs to God. That's why when we read in Acts chapter 14, you can write it down, but we will read at home later. Acts chapter 14, verse 8 to 18, you will see when Paul and Barnabas have performed many miracles, the people in that place that wanted to raise sacrifices and Paul and raise sacrifice to them and worship them as God. And they say, no, we are mere men like you, servant of God. These things is the doing of God. And Paul and Peter, when he went to Cornelius fell down to worship. He said, no, you can't do that. I am a mere man like you. If the apostle who lived with Christ physically, they do not accept worship. So there is no time 2,000 years later, somebody may come and receive worship. Worship belong to God. That's why you will see in the Bible, that's why not no angel or man was godly ever accepted worship. Even when they were mistaken. When they were mistaken, they quickly corrected and said, these things belongs to God. Because the moment you start receiving what belongs to God, your clock starts kicking faster because you have to be out. You are trying to share what exclusively belonging to God. So worship belongs to God. So as human beings, we don't worship men. And I'm saying many human beings, whether they are dead or alive. When they are dead now, I know in Africa we call them ancestors. But then we start doing reverence to them, raising sacrifices to them. But when we do that, it is not unto them, neither unto God. It's unto other spirit. And when the sacrifice has been raised like that, in the same way the true worship of God brings generational blessing, the worship of other things bring also generational, negative generational consequences. That why people sometimes they suffer is because they were worship of other things that were raised in the previous generation. Now you are being affected. Why? Because that's what opened up the door to persecute and to mount that bloodline. So worship belongs to God. So you will see African people, they go to the graveyard, they do things, they do in the name of revealing or unveiling, and they shed blood, they speak things. Those things the dead do not have partition in the living. So when this response is not our ancestor who are responding, it's evil spirit who are responding. Though they can appear even in dreams with the face of our grandmothers, or our grandmothers, or our grandfathers, or our uncles. That's the way the enemy operates. He personificates the person so that he can gain your trust. When you know, wow, it's my grandfather that appeared in my dream saying I must go to the mountain and sacrifice. Therefore, I am going. Where do I find the God so that I go to the mountain? But it is not the grandfather. The dead do not have partition in the living. That's why we don't worship Mary. We don't worship the saints. We don't pray to Paul. We don't pray to Peter. We don't pray to Mary. We have direct access as we are saying last Sunday. Our access has been given is a direct access to Jehovah God. We don't need to go via, but we go straight to God. Because we are priests and we have direct access to God. So you as Christian, we do not worship a human being. Number three, we do not worship angels. Whether they are godly angels or evil angels, we do not worship angel. Revelation 19 verse 9 and 10 says, we don't worship angels. Angels as well, when you are looking at Revelation 19, they are created beings. Just as us also, we are created beings. So we don't worship angels. Now one of the angels had an John had an encounter with the angel. Then he said to me, right, be blessed are those who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true saying of God. That the reaction of the apostle, he said, verse 10, I fell at his feet to worship him. But he said to me, see that you do not do that. I am your fellow servant and of your brethren who have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. And say, hey, even the angels, they know they cannot receive what exclusively belongs to God. So we don't worship angels. Paul says to the Colossians chapter 2 verse 18, let no one cheat you of your reward, taking delight in false humility and worship of angels, intruding into those things which he has not seen, vainly path up by his fleshly mind. Let no one cheat you. And other version will say, let no one capture you. And in South Africa, we know what is to capture is. So let no one capture you and say, let's worship angel. I know we will see it on TV. People even are instructing angel, my angel do this, my angel do that. The angel do not obey men. They are the disposal of Jehovah God. They only hear the instruction of God. As God said it, they move to obey. You a human being, you cannot command that I'm commanding my angels. You do not have access to commanding angels. When it comes to invoking the spiritual realm, it's only to God.
Amen.
It's like here, we are all South African, but none of us here has the power to command the South African army to go and fight on their behalf.
Amen.
But then you are South African.
Amen.
Why? Because they are not at your disposal.
Amen.
They are at the disposal of the president.
Amen.
Not even the minister. Only when the president make a decree, then the army obey. When God make a decree, then the angels move to execute. Human beings don't talk to angels and command them. So the worship of God, we do not worship a body, we do not worship a man, we do not worship angels. And we don't worship any other creature, any other thing. We don't worship the creation. We don't worship any other thing that God created. We don't worship the sun. We don't worship the moon. The stars are not to be worshipped. We don't worship the rivers. We don't worship the creatures. When you read, you can write down in Deuteronomy 4 verse 15 going down, Moses is warning the people when they get to the promised land not to worship other things, because when God spoke to them, they did not see any form or shape of God. And in the end, I think verse 25, he said, for God is a jealous God, a consuming fire. Why is it like that? Because the worship cannot go to any other except God. So you as a human being, we don't worship the body. We don't worship a man, whether that man is alive or is dead long. We don't worship angels. We don't worship any other thing. And the matter of fact is this, you can write it down. The moment a creature worship another creature, it's called idolatry. Because worship only belongs to God. Now, going back to the scripture we read in Revelation chapter 4, if we can put it on the screen, Revelation 4, and they said there are four living creatures, each having six wings, were full of eyes around and within, and they do not rest day or night. Say, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. The entire focus is upon the one sitting on the throne. And when we read earlier in Isaiah, all the seraphims are worshiping And they are amazed. They are even saying it to one another. We're coming back to it just now. But let's talk about quickly about the holiness of God. When we say God is holy, two things must strike your mind. Number one, that God is absolutely distinct from all his creatures. He's totally different. There is no one like God. He's perfect. There is no one who can compare to God. It is different from all other creatures. It is God, and there is no one like him. That one must strike your mind. Number two, when we talk about the holiness of God, is that God is morally perfect. There is no sin in God. There is no flaw in God. There is no wrong motives in God. Everything that emanates from God is holy. It is pure. When he speaks, his intentions are pure. And he does not have wrong motives, wrong thoughts about you. When he says something, it is holy. His correction is holy. His instructions are holy. His rebuke are holy. God is pure. There is no shadow of turning in God. God is morally perfect. There is no sin. So when we say, God, you are holy, those two things must strike your mind. And when these people, the creature, are saying holy, they are not even talking about sin, because in heaven, sin is not there. When it arises, the enemy was kicked out, so it's pure, everything is pure. Meaning the first one, as it fits well into this scripture, when they say, God, you are holy, 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 they are talking about the perfection of God. They are talking about how God is absolutely different from all creature. And when you read the commentaries on this, even on Isaiah, that's why they are saying it in one another. It's they are amazed at how God is different from everyone. It's as if when they are worshiping God, when they come up, they realize he's the king. When they worship God, they come up, they realize, wow, he's the righteous judge. When they worship God, they realize he's everlasting. He has no beginning, no ending. He lives forever and ever. When they worship, they realize, wow, he is the king sitting on the throne. All the privilege belongs to him. All the royal accolade belongs to God. All the royal decree as unto God. When they say you are holy, they are saying, God, you are faithful. When they say you are holy, it is as if they are saying God is eternal. Eternal, it means God, there is no way you can trace when God started, when God will end. God, he has no beginning, no end, because he's a mysterious God that the Bible call him again is the beginning and the end. Yet he has no beginning, no end. When they worship, they realize, wow, he's the provider of everything. When they worship, they realize, wow, he's the Lord who is our healer. As we don't seek for healing, we don't go for blessings, for miracle. All we longing for is that the healer manifest. Because when the healer manifests, anything that is contrary to the healer, it has to leave. That's why we seek to God first. That's why we worship God first. So when they are worshiping, they are saying, you are holy. You are absolutely different. 1 minute you were the provider. Now you are the healer. Now you are the faithful one. You are God who do not forget. You are God who do not falter. You are God who do not forsake. You are God who is faithful. When they are worshiping God, they are amazed at who God is. He is eternal, immortal. They worship. When they rise up, they realize, wow, this guy is the all is omniscient. There is nothing that God does not know. He is all knowing. When they say you are holy, they come up, they realize, wow, God is omnipresent. He is present everywhere at all time in his fullness. When they worship, they realize, wow, God is omnipotent. He possesses all the power. He has no rival. He has no competition. He has no challenger. He is God all by himself. He has no one to compete with. He's sitting on the throne. When the devil tried, he did not even step out of the throne. The angel and the archangel has to deal with it. Michael, the minister of defense, has to deal with the enemy to kick him out. Because God is holy, absolutely different. The entire heavens, I say, holy. Wow, this is amazing. He was omniscient. Now he's omnipotent. He was omnipotent. Now he's all knowing. He was all knowing. Now he's the provider. He's the provider. At the same time, he's Adonai, the landlord of the entire universe. So they are all focusing on him as the object of worship. So when it's come to worship, there must be an object of worship. As Christians, this is our object of worship. The one sitting on the throne of glory. Number two, what time are we stopping? We were dealing still with the object of worship. And saying, it is not a bully, it is not a man, it is not angels, it is not any other thing, but only God. So we're dealing with object of worship. When it's come to worship of God, there must be an object of worship. Number two, when we go to this scripture, Revelation 4, our main scripture, and it says, and the four living creatures, which you must memorize by now, each having six wings, were full of eyes around and within, and they do not rest. Day or night say, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Notice what comes next. Whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne, who lives forever and ever. Verse 10 now is key. He says what? The 24 elders fall down before him who sit on the throne and worship him, who lives forever and ever. So when it's come to the worship of God, we have number one, the object of worship. Number two, the act of worship. These are falling down. Now to fall down, it's referred to as to prostrate or prostration. And you will see one of the definition of worship. It means to prostrate oneself unto another. It means it's a worship or it's a show of reverence, of showing respect, of showing adoration. The person goes on the floor to worship. That was when the wise men, they came in the room, they saw Mary and the child Jesus. They worshiped Jesus. They fell down on the floor and worshiped. Thereafter, they opened their treasure. So worship, there is a falling down. And there is also the aspect of kneeling down to show reverence to God. Keep on following me. So in prostration, when they are falling down, it means the person two knees, two hands, the forehead and the nose all touch the ground at the same time. It's a way of showing reverence, the highest form of worship. And when I am lying down there like that in worship, I don't have time to WhatsApp. Because otherwise I am divided between WhatsApp and Jehovah God. That way in worship, it's only God that matters. I know I came with my wife, but when it's come to worship, it is as if it's between me and God. There is no phone. There is no WhatsApp. There is no Facebook. There is no this. There is no joking around. This is a serious matter. I want to express my worship to God. That way they are lying down. However, now, this is a way that you will see in the Bible. It is used from the Eastern culture to express worship. But in the Bible as well, you will see is a way of expressing the highest reverence. That's why you will see in the Old Testament and the New Testament, you have these pictures. Keep on following me. We're going somewhere. For instance, Joshua. Let's read Joshua chapter 5, verse 13, verse 14. Let's go straight to verse 14 because of time. Verse 14. So he said, this is Joshua at Jericho. He has this encounter with the Lord himself appearing in the physical. I'm sure, I don't know if you have talked about theophany. It means the physical manifestation of God on earth before he was born in Bethlehem. Amen. So he appears and said, no, but as commander of the army of the Lord, I have now come. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and worship. Meaning he prostrate. He realized, whoa, I have an encounter with God on the floor because no flesh should glory in the presence of God. Now when we come to the New Testament quickly because of time, in Matthew chapter 2 verse 11, when the wise men also appear in the presence of Mary and Jesus the child, they worship the child, not Mary, they worship the child. And says, and when, verse 11, and when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary's mother and fell down and worshiped him. And when they had opened their treasure, they presented the gift of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Another debate for another day. But I'm talking about the falling down that day to express worship. So in Revelation that we read, John, when the heavens open, is seeing this scene, and the 24 elders are falling down, and that is demonstration that their posture of falling down is indicative that they do not give God any lesser type of worship. Here on earth, whether we fall down, we kneel or not, but our heart expression in worship must be the one that gives God the highest form of worship. Now we are seeing this picture so that you may have, it may ring within you that they were not giving God any lesser type of worship. As they were falling down like that. So as I am saying, whether we do fall down now, or you kneel down or you don't, but when it's come to expressing worship, it must be the highest form of worship from your heart to God. Which can lead you sometimes into kneeling down. Which can lead you sometimes into lying on the floor in reverence to God. But it's not necessarily about kneeling down or falling down. You may kneel down, but your heart is far from the kneeling down. When you wake up, you realize you are dirty, then you have to go and clean your clothes. But I am talking about the kneeling down, where it's out of reverence for God as a way of worshiping God. So when we are doing this, it's an individual experience. Last Sunday I say when it's come to worship, it's an individual experience. That's why we can pray together. I can pray for you. We can praise God together, but no one will be able to worship God for you. It's an individual experience. That way you will see in worship, we are all worshiping here, but you see one day at the corner, their worship is expressive and tears coming down. Nobody said to them cry. It's the way their heart is expressing worship to God. Another one, when you look around, they are kneeling down. This other one cannot help but words coming out, song coming out, because it's a heart expression of who God is. To worship. So someone can pray for you, others can praise God with you, but no one can worship God for you. No one can express how you perceive God on your behalf. It has to be an individual experience. When you read, I will just quote them, Songs of Songs 6 verse 3 is expressing like a love relationship between two people. He said, I am my beloved and my beloved is mine. It's not saying my beloved is ours, because Songs of Songs present our relationship with God as a loving relationship. He said, my beloved is mine. And then when you read verse 1 to 2, chapter 1 verse 2 of Songs of Songs, he said, let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth, for your love is better than wine. I am not talking about the holy kiss, but he is demonstrating intimacy, that when he is about to kiss, you don't just do it anyhow. And if you are a lady, the man does not just run to your lips anyhow, anyway. It has to be closed out. The outside has to be closed out, because this is an intimacy, a one-on-one encounter. It's like worship. It means I am shutting out the external world. I am looking in with my God. And the reason of looking in with my God is not because of me, it's because of him. Hence it is worship. It means I am approaching God, not because I need something, but it's because of who he is. Not that I need healing, but because he's my maker and I was created for worship. So when I am approaching God, it's because of who he is. It's an intimacy. Amen. And the scripture bring us the intimacy between the two people, the expression of worship. We read Luke now 5 verse 12. The expression of worship, it is like you are coming out from the crowd into a one-on-one interaction with God.
Amen.
And the reason of the interaction is not because of you, it's because of God. Now in Luke chapter 5 verse 12, it says, and it happened when he was in a certain city, that Jesus, that behold, a man full of leprosy saw Jesus and fell on his face, that to prostrate before Jesus. Behold, and when the scripture says behold, it means the Bible wants to bring something to your attention that is not out, is out of the ordinary, or they are trying to bring something to you that they don't want you to miss out. As he said, behold, a man full of leprosy. If you read this same passage in Matthew chapter 8, you can write down, when this encounter happened, there is a multitude following Jesus. But the Bible does not say, behold, a multitude following Jesus. Why? Because in those days, it was ordinary for the multitude to be following Jesus every time he is in the public. As it's not saying, behold. But when it come to Luke, the physician, he put this description when he identified the man of leprosy. He said, and behold, a man full of leprosy. And he saw, he fell on his face. Saw Jesus and he fell on his face. And imploring him, saying, Lord, if thou willest that thou can make me clean, let deal with it and break it down now. He said, behold, say, pay attention to what is about to be declared here, what is about to be shown here. It is outside the ordinary. Behold, a man full of leprosy. In those days when you have leprosy, you cannot appear among the people. You have to be outside the camp, and you cannot be among where the people are interacting. Hence the Bible says, is behold, because it's outside the ordinary for a leper to come and mingle with the other people. And it said, behold, a man full of leprosy. And it's not only leprosy, but it's full of leprosy. In other words, the leprosy is a full-blown leprosy. The only thing a man full of leprosy, when you study, the only thing that is awaiting them is for the body just to collapse and die. But this man saw Jesus. He knew when it's come to worship, the people want to worship for me. I have to appear before the Lord by myself. As he's dragging himself, full of leprosy, it means the fingers are cut off. Some of the fingers have fallen just like that. The toes are not there. The hair is not there. He has sores everywhere. Flies are following him. Flies everywhere. He has wound, but he's still coming. The joint are twisted, but he's still coming. He's not stopping from worshiping God. I know sometimes as pastor, you will ask somebody, where were you? Not in church. But today on Monday, you are at work. You will say, no, I had a headache, so I couldn't come to church. But this man, full of leprosy, meaning a headache is a small thing. A pain in the back is a small thing. They have to come. He has no finger, but he's still coming to worship God. He's full of leprosy, means his house is burned. He has been declared unclean. He has to live outside the city. If you are married, the marriage is separated because you can't be in the same house. Anybody who come in contact with you, they declare unclean. So, but he has, is still coming. That the scenario of this man is not stopping from coming to the Maker. Is not coming, stopping from coming to the Lord. Is approaching God. Have you been in a situation where you have lost everything? You go here, they reject you. You try this, they stop you. You say here, they mock you. But you are pushing yourself and say, as for my Lord, I will not leave. As for my worshiper, I will not stop it. I am dragging myself. I know they can pray for me. I know they can praise God together with me. But when it's come to worship, here I am, Lord, all by myself. It means when the crowd saw this, is an amazing scene. Answer, Luke says, behold, a man full of leprosy. He has no fingers. He has no tools. It means his walk is affected. You don't know how he's walking, but he's coming to the Lord. And when he gets to the Lord, he's not asking for things. He's not asking for healing first. He's falling to the ground in pain, but to the ground. Without fingers, but to the ground. Rejected, but to the ground. Forsaken, but to the ground. Outcast, but to the ground. Rejected, but to the ground. With no money, but to the ground. The children gone, but to the ground. The wife gone, but to the ground. He's coming and lie down and prostrate before God in worship. And then the Bible says, say, Lord. And now after he has fallen on his face and besought him and said, Lord, if thou willest, if you are willing, it means when I fell to the ground, it is not because I am not asking you for healing because I fell on the ground. Falling on the ground is part of me worshiping you. Now I am appealing to you out of your kindness, out of your goodness, out of your mercy. If you can make me clear, there is something that touches the heart of God. It is called worship. When you worship God with everything in you, it draws heaven attention. It attracts God. The God focus now is on you because the altar is raising worship. God has to respond. That's what Jesus said, I am willing, and be made clear immediately. The leprosy left. I know sometimes, especially nowadays, a Christian, when you didn't eat yesterday, there is no way you'll show up in church. The pastor has to understand that your tummy has nothing. You have headache, you have pain, but on Monday you go into work still with headache. But that's another matter for another day. But the one that makes you, you're giving him excuse, but the one that pays your salary, you are submit to him whether you have a headache or not. But when God realizes your heart is after him and him alone, he responds. When it's come to worship, worship is an individual experience. No one can worship God for you. So I am praying, oh, back to God fellowship. As your worship ascend before God, let God intervene. As you raise worship before God, let him respond. As you raise worship before God, let him scatter your enemies. Sometimes you're crying, they are persecuting me. But the weapon you have in your hand is to draw worship to God. When God sees worship, he responds. And when he responds, he's the man of war. He come and scatter anything that he disturbs. When God responds, he is the healer. When you have the worshiper there as a sickness and respond to the worship, there is no way the healing, the sickness can stay there because God has responded. I am praying to you. May you be a congregation of worshiper. Maybe you be individual in your own house raising worship to God. As worshiper sent before God, let him come down. Let him scatter your enemies. The door where you have been rejected, it has to open now because the Lord has responded. And when he has come to worship, any need around the worshiper has to be met because he looks at the heart. This heart is after me. This is like a heart of David. Though the person has sinned, but they are running to God and say, you are the only one that needs. God has to respond. When it's come to worship, there is no way God will not respond. Amen. God respond when it's come to worship. Let's go to number 3 and close. Oh, number 3, we go back to the scripture. Revelation chapter 4, verse 8, 9, 10, 11. Verse 8 says, then the four living creatures, oh, worship. I know we give God excuses. Why are you not doing this? No, I am sick, pastor. Why are you not praying? I am sick, pastor. But this man had all those things. Remember when you study leprosy, And this case is full of leprosy. It means is all is awaiting is for the body to collapse and die. But he's coming to Jesus. When he saw, he came. He's supposed to be outside the city according to the law of Moses. He cannot be seen in the public. He can't touch because anything he touches must be declared unclean. He can't talk to people. When he talks to them, they must be declared unclean. Now, when that's the scenario, that the picture of this guy, but still is dragging himself to the Lord. Meaning nowadays, there is no excuse that will make you not worship God.
Amen.
Because this guy had everything. Outside the camp, he has no money. If he had the house is declared unclean and can even be burnt. So it means he has lost everything. If he had children, is not, the children are gone because they can't interact with him because they'll be declared unclean. If he had a wife, the wife cannot be with him because the wife will be declared unclean. So he is rejected in pain because of leprosy, in pain emotionally because he's outside, is waiting to die. But he's coming to the Lord. So there is no excuse for the 21st century Christian to stop worshiping God because God did not answer their prayer yesterday about the money they are looking for. Because they have been waiting for a husband for 5 years. He has not showed up. So God, I cannot worship you because that prayer is not answered. But when it's come to worship, it's not about you. It's about him. He may not have an answer yet. You may not have the car of your dream. You may not have the certificate you need. You may not have the wigs you want. You may not be living in the house you want. But the worship of God cannot be stopped.
Amen.
When the worship is there, God responds. And he says, verse 8, the four living creatures, each having six wings, were full of eyes around and within. And they do not rest day and night. Say, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Whenever the living creature give glory and honor and thanks to him who sit on the throne, the object of worship, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him, the act of worship, who sit on the throne and worship him, who lives what forever and ever. And what did they do? They cast their crowns before the throne. So it is not worship until the crown you have on, it is cast down. From human being perspective, when you have crown, when you have achievement, when you have this and that, they value you. But in worship is the reverse. The value that you have, if it is cast down so you can worship God, is called worship. So you cannot come in worship. I know you've got the PhD, but when it's come to worship before your maker, the PhD head has to come down so that my worship can arise before God. I know I am married, but my marriage is temporarily suspended so that I may be able to raise worship to God. My crown cannot interfere with worship. So casting crowns before the throne of God. A crown symbolizes, as we are closing now, symbolizes the reward we have for before God because of the race that we are running in. If you write down, you can write 1 Corinthians 9, 24, 25. 2 Timothy 4, 8. And 1 Peter 5, 4. Is showing us the crown that we receive as a reward from God because of the race we have run as Christians. That's why 1 Peter 5 verse 4 says, when the chief shepherd appears, you shall receive the crown of glory that does not fade away. However, while here on earth, there are two main ideas of crown that that I want us to deal with. Number one, a crown. When you see now in the Old Testament especially, when the high priest is made high priest, they put a crown on him to show that he's separated and exalted into that position. When a king is anointed as a king, they put a crown on him. So crown symbolizes exaltation, coming into a position of authority or a higher position, separated, as you have the crown on. Idea number one. Idea number two, when it's come to crown, is showing that now is the achievement, the things that you have acquired in life. Are we together? That one, especially in Proverbs and in Psalms, it describing, for instance, when somebody has a good wife, they say it is a crown.
Yes.
Proverbs 12 verse 4. When somebody's now he's got grandchildren, you have lived to see your grandchildren, they say the grandchildren have become like a crown. Proverbs 17 verse 6. And when you have riches, you have made it big time. It is a crown. And when you have a harvest, you have harvested. Psalms 65 verse 11, call it a crown. And as Christian having a relationship with God, Isaiah prophesied and call it a crown. Isaiah 28 verse 5. So as a crown, it means now when now one cast the crown, like there they said they cast their crown before the throne of God. Casting a crown is an act of submission. It means when I cast down my crown before a person, I am acknowledging that they are more superior than I am. Hence I have to cast my crown. I am showing respect. I am paying homage. When I appear before the king, I cannot appear with my head on when the king's head is on also. Mine has to be cast down so that I acknowledge the king. So now the picture here now is that when it's come to worship, all that you have become, whether you are a pastor, you are an archbishop, whether you are a professor, whether you have achieved a PhD, whether you are a millionaire in town, whether the car you drive is the only one in South Africa, it is like a crown upon your head. Now worship, it means a crown must be cast down. So when I appear before the Lord in worship, I know I have my PhD, but if I can be able to go beyond my PhD and worship God, it means my crown has been cast down. Casting crown, it means though I am rich, my bank account is got 6 zeros, now it's going to 7, 8, 9, 0, and upside can testify of that. But when it's come to worship, the zeros beyond my numbers in the account should not interfere with the worship of God. Casting crowns, it means yes, I am a doctor, yes, I qualify for 7 years to study a medical degree, now I am a doctor, my doctorate degree, me becoming a gynecologist or a surgeon, but if I cannot worship God, it means my crown is still there and my worship cannot ascend before God when my crown is on me. I know you have a PhD, I know your marriage is good, but to be able to kneel down before the Lord, regardless of how good your marriage is, regardless of how much money you have, regardless of how who you are in the society, your position, the things that people say, do you know who I am? If you can go beyond that, do you know who I am? And be able to worship God and be able to adore God, it is casting crown. It is saying, God, though I am a bishop, though I am the archbishop, I have the gift, I have all this revelation, I can see things, but I can be able to ignore those and worship God. It is called casting crowns. Though I am called a bishop, I know there are churches where the pastor just walking to hold the microphone and preach. He does not have time for the prayer people are doing. They do not have time for the worship people are doing. It is as if they have already overgrown that. Now all they wait for is worship, is pray, is preaching. But I am telling you, regardless of whether you are a bishop, if you can kneel down and worship God, it's called casting crown. Your crown cannot stand. Your crown cannot restrain you. Your crown cannot stop you. Your achievement cannot stop you. Your gender cannot stop you. Your level level of authority in society cannot stop you from worshiping God until the crowns are cast down. It is not worship until I can go beyond my millions. It is not worship until my PhD cannot be in my head and stopping me from worshiping God. Until I am, when I'm up there, when I greet people, I greet them like that, because I don't want them to date me. I've got too much money for them to date me. Until you can go beyond that, it is not worship until you are able to say, yes, I've got all this. This is my house. It's one of my 20 houses. But when the 20 house cannot interfere with your worship, it is not a worship until the crown are cast down. It is not a crown. That's why in the Bible, great men and women of God, every time they have an encounter with God, they go to their knees, they go on the floor. Because though I am great in the sight of people, God, you are still higher than I am. God, you are still superior than I am. And the reason you created me is for worship. And the things I've acquired is because of you. The gift I have is because of you. The possession I have is because of you. So all these things, when they are put aside, in order for me to express worship, it is called casting crowns. Amen. When the crown is on, it is not worship. Amen. Though we can see you crying, but the moment you know, my neighbor here must know who I am. I have 2 PhD. My bank account is this big. That huge car outside is mine. You don't know where I am staying. Do you know who I am? The moment you can't go beyond, do you know who I am? You can't worship God. Because the crown is still on. Do you know how many men follow after me? You are still having the crown on. Do you know how beautiful my wife is? The crown is on. Do you know how big my house is? The crown is on. Until the crown is cast, it is not worship.
Amen.
The worship of God. We will stop it here. The number 4 in there is called words of worship. That's what they are saying. There is no way you will appear in the presence of God. There is nothing coming. The reflection of God, something has to come out. Amen. To express worship. Amen. That's another one for another day. When it's come to words of worship, that's what even what the people are saying there in the Bible, it is about God. Words of worship coming out as a way of expressing worship to God.
Amen.
When we are worshiping God here on earth, the only object of worship is God. When we are expressing our worship, he must receive the highest form of worship. Because at this all the time, that's what he's receiving. You cannot give him a change, or you cannot do him a favor. That's why he said God is not worshiping man's hand as though he needed anything. Because it is he who gives to all life and breath and all things. And it can't be worship when your crowns are still on. They have to be cast out. And when you appear in the presence of the king, words cannot be bottled in, but they have to come about who God is. And if there are people here, if you have lived in the kingdom, you will see when people are coming to the king's palace, they are praising the king. You've built the road. You've done this. We didn't have the bridge. Now you have built the bridge. When they are outside, it means they are praising the king because of what he has done. Hence praise is telling a story about what God has done. But when they appear in the throne room where the king is sitting, they're no longer talking about the bridge. They say, long live the king. This about now the focus changes from what he has done to who he is. That's worship. When you have been praising, hence when we are coming out from the crowd, we are telling you have healed us, you delivered us. 2 years ago I was born. I was like this, but the devil was cast out of me. I was like that, but you have done this. I didn't have a job, but you have given me a job. I didn't have a wife, now I've got the wife. I am praising God.
Amen.
I am telling a story.
Amen.
about what he has done. But when I appear now, it's a one-on-one. It is now about him. You are holy. You are mighty. You are sovereign. You are everlasting. There is no one who can compare with you. You live forever and ever. Now the focus changes to God. I worship. Oh, I don't know if you can rise up. Let's worship God before we pray. Let the glory, there is a song we sing, let the glory rise.